to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Adequate notice of this meeting has been provided pursuant to the New Jersey Open Public Meetings Law by posting a notice on the bulletin board in the municipal building and faxing, emailing a copy of that notice along with the agenda of this meeting to the Press of Atlantic City, Atlantic County Record, Record Journal, and current newspapers stating this meeting would take place at 6:30 p.m. on Monday, December 7th, 2015, in the Municipal Building, Mays Landing, New Jersey. Ms. Gatto?
Here.
Mr. Gishard?
Present.
Mr. Kurtz?
Here.
Mrs. Link?
Here.
Mayor Silva?
Here. Can we take a moment of silence for private reflection? Please, everyone, keep in your thoughts and prayers the victims in California of the terrorist attack, and pray for anybody else who's been victimized by all the tragedies that have occurred in this country over this month, and hopefully that we won't witness too many more. We have a GIFT update presentation by our fund commissioner, Ingrid. Getting pictures too? Huh?
Doing. By way of background, for those who may not know, or to refresh, what is the Joint Insurance Fund? Can you hear me in the microphone, okay, everybody?
Yeah, ask Lisa.
Yes. Yes. All right. It is a tax dollar financed organization made up of 41 towns that pool the risk for their towns and participate actively in the administration of this fund. It provides the township protection from loss, it provides risk management, it provides safety and training resources. The types of coverage that we have through the GIF, we have a self-insured retention of $300,000, meaning that claims up to $300,000 for workers' comp, general liability, and property claims are covered. I'm gonna go back.
You hit the arrow to the left, it should take you back.
There we go, sorry. The mail claims coverage is up to $1,450,000. That's large claims, which are workers' comp, general liability, and property that are above $300,000. And then they also provide what's called EPL and POL claims coverage, which is employment practices, liability and public officials' liability. And those coverage levels are different, and our deductibles are different with that as well. We have a $10,000 deductible on that. So that's pretty much the coverage. Why is the GIF beneficial to our township? And this is the part where we talk about the things I really like about the GIF. It's member run, so all of the towns have an active voice in how the organization runs. It is a data-driven organization, which means they really pay a lot of attention to taking the data about claims and taking the data about safety and participating in nationwide organizations that track these things, and they use all of that very effectively to run the organization. The overall cost for coverage for us is good. They are very safety conscious. They provide good and efficient care for our employees who might be injured. There are a lot of value-added features. There are hotlines that you can call for information. There are blog postings that you can put up. There are networking sites that you can use with other towns if you have ideas or something you want to run by another member. And they're ethical. Right now, we're in the middle of doing an RFQ for legal counsel for all of our different types of claims, and I am sitting in the middle of reviewing all of these, which is, as you know, reviewing these RFQs for professionals can be cumbersome. So we are doing that at the JIF level too, and that's something that we've been phasing in over the last 5 years or so. We write the spec for a different set of professionals every year, so finally we're at the point where they're almost all, I think they're all done by RFQ now, which was not the case previously. So that's a good practice, and it's something I'm proud to be able to say that they're doing now. They also do a lot of very good comprehensive reviews of the different groups that run the different functions in the JIF, the groups that run the workers' comp function, that run the medical functions of the JIF. They each review each other and meet with each other frequently, and it's nice because there are good ideas that come out of that. It's not just kind of everybody's doing a great job and that's it. They do pick up issues and they do deal with issues, and it's done very efficiently. So what helps us save money with the JIF? The member input in committees and seminars. I participate in the claims committee, and I'm chairing that committee, and I have for the last couple of years. So that's a great experience because you really learn a lot from doing that. The legal team's subrogation efforts with claims that may not be something that the JIF would pay, but payment may be available through another carrier for someone who might have caused an accident. Their efforts are outstanding, and they've actually hit an all-time high in 2015 with their subrogation recovery. The training is wonderful. At no cost, we have trainers that come to our facility and other local town facilities, and we can share that. If there's a class happening in Galloway that we need, we can send folks over there. Same thing, they can send their people to ours. And the training is quality. In fact, this year, with the safety organization, they have added a retired police officer so that they can make the training efforts for the police departments better, even than they've been. We have a good transitional duty program. That is something that helps us save, that we can manage here at the township level. If we have injured employees, their recommendations for transitional duty will help guide us to bringing those employees back to work perhaps earlier than they might have. And it makes a smoother and more productive return to work, and it definitely keeps them out of work for less time. And the managed health care, they are always doing things to look at the services that are provided and how much they cost. They have a great core group of doctors. They try to keep all of the costs inside network for the group, and that does an awful lot of good to save money. Some highlights from 2015. Again, the expanded training opportunities for police departments. They have put staff on for that. That's just kind of beginning this year. They have some stress management classes, and they have a separate employment practices class for police staff only, which can help narrow down the focus and really provide material that's good for those specific jobs. There's been the last couple of years a renewed focus on the EPL POL training. I know that some of you just went.
All of us.
Yeah, we all did.
Yeah. So that not only does that save us money when you all go, saves us some money on our premium, it also talks about the things that you can run into as an elected official that might, that the ways to handle it. Our management employees are also trained in that, and that's coming up. And we also have training that we provide to all the members of our boards and commissions as well. So that it just teaches about ethics in the workplace. This year, that's new. We have a wellness incentive program. They've given us $1,000 to spend on wellness activities, which we've started doing that already by providing a healthy luncheon to our public works department to talk about eating right during extended response times and overnight, so that you don't put a lot of coffee and sugar into yourself. You might want to choose some healthier options. And we are also working. We have a wellness committee that's just been established here at the township to move forward with some other, maybe lunch talks and things like that that would help the employees. Because if you keep your employees well, and perhaps they do get injured, they come back quicker if they're in a healthy way when they're injured. The other thing for this year I want to highlight, and I'll talk about it a little bit more, the thing I've had the hardest time remembering how to say is the Aggregate Excess Loss Contingency Fund. And that's, you know, what is that? That is a fund that we can put portions of our dividends into. Now, they give us back dividends every year for money that doesn't get spent out of the premiums. And that's just gone up a lot. We got a small dividend last year. We had none the year before because the claims costs had been high in the pool. Everybody's bringing their claims costs down, and so our dividend is going up, which is great. Last year, we put part of the dividend towards our premium and 15,000 of it into this Aggregate Excess Loss Contingency Fund. And what that fund does is it's there at the JIF. It's not part of our municipal budget, but it's money that is aside as they call it a rainy day fund. If we have a cost for a claim that's unexpected, something that goes on, we can pull from that fund in order to pay any costs that would be associated with it. So it's a good place to put money. It earns money at the same rate that the JIF is earning money, and it's really a good option.
So then that mitigates a hit to the claims cost.
Exactly.
Overall?
Okay, yeah.
Got it.
And tonight, you'll see on the agenda, we have another resolution as far as disbursement of our dividend, and I've asked that another 15,000 be put in there. So we'll have 30,000 in there. And if at some point we don't use that money for a claim of some kind and we don't have one, which is how I hope it is, then some year we may want to just put it towards the premium, and we're allowed to do that.
Okay,
as well.
Cool.
So it works really well. So where are we going? Some of the things I wanted to highlight that we've done through the safety committee and with some of the money that we get in our safety budget. A couple of years ago, we included a court person on our safety committee, and they brought to us that the Department of Corrections has requirements for them, safety requirements, and that they needed to come into compliance with those. They were at the same level as any other court in the vicinage, but they were eager to do this. So after we finish this ballistic glass project that's going on right now, we'll put ballistic glass in the court windows. We've already put in the different way to get in the courtroom. We've got the metal detector out there. Once this is done, we will have achieved everything that is necessary. We'll be in complete compliance with the DOC safety guidelines in the court. And that's an excellent thing, and we're far ahead of a lot of other courts in the vicinage. We just had our annual court safety meeting the other day. So it's an offshoot of what happens as a result of having this safety committee. We've done some safety improvements on the administrative side, added additional panic buttons for the safety of our customers and our staff. And that was done with money that we get from the JIF. The $30,000 set aside for future costs, not in the municipal budget, that's the Aggregate Excess Loss Contingency Fund. Our premium this year is going to remain fairly flat with a 0.11 projected increase, which is really excellent. So we're going to take part of our dividend and put it towards that and bring it down even more. So in conclusion, just that we are consistently complying with all the requirements. We receive safety incentive funding each year. We continue to improve our reporting. We continue to work together. This is actually the same slide I used last year because it is the truth. And we are working to increase awareness throughout all departments, especially when it comes to our most costly claims, and those are the EPL, POL. So I've actually been able to talk at some of our agenda meetings about, or one of our agenda meetings about those types of claims and explain them a little better to our department heads and make sure they know that we're available to answer any questions. So do you have any questions of me?
I think you, not a question, a compliment.
Well,
I hope everybody's aware of the good work you do as the JIF coordinator. And of course, you have other people in the township working with you.
Absolutely.
And I know they're of a great value to you and to keep all these safety programs and awareness programs alive. So we thank you and appreciate your continual oversight of looking out for the township.
Well, thank you very much.
Yes, and I did have. Yeah, I would say for a great job. And just to give you an idea from the meeting that we attended, the seminar, to see what's changing so quickly in the insurance world, they actually discussed the meeting, JIF having to insure drones in coming up now for municipalities that use drones for engineering and different studies within their municipalities. It was quite an interesting seminar. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, they do keep themselves abreast of the latest concerns, and that's good.
I just had two questions. You mentioned a wellness incentive program, which sounds like a great idea. What is the incentive, and is there a way of measuring how well it works?
Well, that's in the works right now. We have a wellness committee set up. I guess my thought was the incentive was they have $1,000 seed money for the township to set this up and to do some activities. So they're still working the wellness committee on what they might want to do, whether it's a Biggest Loser program, like I said, or to bring in some lunchtime talks or have some blood pressure screenings, that sort of thing.
That sounds great. The other question, you mentioned that the GIF, one thing nice about it, it accepts the people run it, the members run it. And you said you were proud of the fact that now they're going out with RFQs for just about everything.
Yes.
Was that part of your urging that they're doing that?
I wish. I mean, it's part of everybody's. It's part of the overall plan that had started. I do participate in these committees where we talk about how to draft the requests and the types of things that we would like to see in those professionals. So in that respect, yes. But I'm certainly not the driving force behind it.
All right. Great work. Thank you.
Ingrid, when I was at the senior health fair over in, Weymouth, I spoke to a gal from GIF, and she indicated that if our senior group put together a senior health care day, that maybe our people could go over there to, you know, see what it was all about, and it would be something that would be contributing to our that wealth and
certainly it's very possible.
Yeah, so I do have the person's name. I'll drop it off to you.
That would be great. That's great.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, Ingrid.
You're
good
welcome.
Job, Ingrid.
Okay, the next item on the agenda, there'll be no adjournment to executive session, nor will there be any confirmation. Addition, deletion of late items for consideration tonight.
So moved.
Second.
A motion is second. Questions or comments? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. Early public comment on agenda items not listed for public hearings. Do you have one there, Mike?
Yes, Lisa Castellano.
Yeah, well, Lisa, we spoke. I asked you. When we get to that item here, it'll be item E under discussions is the Alliance. Then we'll engage you at that time, okay? The first item under discussion is the Atlantic County Central Dispatch Plan. And back in November, I guess the second week, there was a meeting held at the vocational school in which the county did present a conceptual of the building that they had planned to build out at Stockton, on land that was donated by the college. I believe it was close to 10 acres. And at that meeting, the conceptual looked fine, but then the meeting seemed to fall apart because a lot of the numbers that the county had were older. They were from 2013. And there were a lot of questions that were being asked. So most of the occupants in attendance left that meeting somewhat dissatisfied with the way that they handled, the way the county handled that presentation. And it was quiet for a while, and then, of course, last Saturday in the press, on the front page, there was an article entitled, "The Dispatch Center was Delayed." Okay? And, of course, I could accept that. But then all of a sudden, the other day, we got notified that they were going to have a meeting this Tuesday night at the Canale Center at 7 o'clock to discuss the Dispatch Center to find out if the towns are on board or not. And of course, if you look at the presentation that they delivered, half of the towns would be favored in it. They would actually save money, and half wouldn't. My big problem with the plan all along was that in their overall budget, they really didn't include equipment and the cost of construction. And obviously, it would be difficult to make any decision when you don't have all your costs. I think anybody who deals with that on a day-to-day basis realizes you can't make a decision without having all the numbers. The other problem was the fact that there were no line items for county dispatch or for Stockton dispatch, and they're going to dispatch for them. So there's a lot of uncertainty going into this thing. And probably the other biggest issue that bothered me, why do we need it at this time? And why in a down economy, if you opened up today's paper, there were 15 pages in a classified section of foreclosures, why would the county go out to bond for, now it's down to 17 million, it was 31 million before, went down to 25, now it's between 17 and 22. It's a lot of confusions. Regardless, why would you go out to bond for that kind of money when things aren't even settled in Atlantic City? And Atlantic City is not going to be one of the favorite individuals here. They're probably going to pay a couple of $100,000 more if they go into a county dispatch. So I think there's a, at this meeting Tuesday night, I think there'll be a lot of questions asked and a lot of uncertainty, nor do I believe any decision could be made. But the other reason for bringing it up is I wanted to make sure that committee understood, they do have copies of the presentation, that they're on board with it, and they understand the path that we're going down now. We've always been opponents of this plan from day one, because I think we have one of the finest dispatch centers in the county right here in this Absolutely. Township. With state-of-the-art, a state-of-the-art program in there with the with our programs, with our dispatching, the quality of our dispatchers, and the job that they do in such a large amount of territory. When you talk 115 square miles, not even taken into account. In fact, if you look at the three large municipalities between Galloway, Egg Harbor, and Hamilton Township, you're looking at over 300 square miles of space that they cover. That's a lot. And when you're talking about life safety, every second counts, I think we've got to be very careful here. As you know, most of us spend in our budget the majority of our money on public safety. And I think we're going to continue to do that. And I'm not about to say what we're going to do or not to do, but we're waiting for a lot of things to unfold. And I do believe we have a lot of unanswered questions. And I believe committee should be versed on this. And of course, I know at the last meeting, there were several of us there. Amy was there, I was there, Rodney was there. And I think we got a good taste of what isn't happening. And I think we've got to have those questions answered. So I did want this on the agenda, and I believe I wanted to just open it up for any type of comments that you want to make on it.
Can I?
Yeah, please.
Okay. Just to give a little bit more background and just kind of where we have been with this. So I think since the time that at least I've been on committee, which is going on the end of my eighth year now, at any of the Atlantic County League meetings, the Atlantic County Mayor's Association meetings, I mean, you name it, it's been a topic of discussion. And I don't feel we're any farther today than we've been in the past 8 years that I've been on committee. I'm sure some of the more seasoned guys out there have probably been talking about this even longer than I've been on committee. We have been opponents of it from day one. We have been the only municipality who has not gotten on board with it through the many discussions that have gone on. And it's very simple. We have asked, show us the money, show us the data. Time and time again, and we have not seen it. In April of this past year, we asked Jerry Del Rosso to come in. We drafted a memo with our questions in writing to have a conversation, to talk, and we walked out of that meeting with really no answers. Some of the things that we asked were answered in the presentation to our surprise. We asked it in April. We wondered why we got the answer in October. It was very confusing. I think you're being very kind to say that people left there a little frustrated. I left there extremely frustrated. I think that there is not a strong sense of the cost information, of the savings information. The information that we have, they collected off the side of a desk, and it's from 2013. They did not ask for the data in any kind of standardized approach. So they just said, what's your expense for dispatch? They didn't ask, do you receive offsetting costs for dispatch? So for example, Egg Harbor City is gonna say their cost is $176,000 because that's what they pay us as part of our shared service agreement. Our cost, when you look, if we were just to hand that number, would be around $770,000, mm-hmm. I think it is, or $710,000. But we have an offset cost because of that revenue that we receive. So they didn't ask about any of that. They didn't ask, do we dispatch for anybody else, or does any other town dispatch for anybody else? They don't take into consideration that if we were to lose that, we lose best practice points for not having shared service agreements, by the way. and it just completely impacts our budget from having lost that. So I think the cost information that they've collected is, it's not standardized, it's not consistent across the board, and I don't think that then produces an actual estimate of savings. I know you referenced it, Mayor, but I just don't think it's accurate. If they would have spent the money that they spent on the plan that they delivered in October on the building, which is a very pretty new building, which includes a new police station for Stockton, by the way, to verify the numbers and put together a sound business plan to say, does this make sense or not, I think we'd be having a much different conversation. But to put something out that shows, here's the shiny new building, here's what everybody's going to be getting, by the way, we're not going to hire anybody who's not a civil service employee, so if you're not a civil service employee, which we aren't, your guys are going to have to get on the list, so they're going to have to take the test, and they're going to have to come in behind whoever's already on the list. You know, there's no plan for how they would transition from all of our disparate dispatch centers to a centralized. There's no plan. So how are we supposed to plan ahead from a budget perspective if we have no idea what the cost is, we have no idea of the accurate savings, and we have no idea of a timeline? We all, as municipalities, have to maintain equipment year over year to ensure the safety of our responders and ensure the safety of our residents that they're responding to. We can't invest in equipment if we have no idea how long we need to be thinking ahead for. So it has been an extremely frustrating process for me personally, as we've been the public safety liaisons for many years, Mayor. We have consistently asked the same question. We consistently do not get any answers. I still do not think we have any answers. And it would be my recommendation to this committee that we remain steadfast in, we are not interested in moving to centralized dispatch. We have no sense of the money. And also, we don't want to sacrifice any sense of safety to our residents. That's where I am.
Ronnie, you were there.
I guess I certainly don't want to repeat the many of the points that were already brought out, but there are a couple that I think are worth noting. One, we keep hearing that we're the only municipality that hasn't agreed to this, and actually that is not true. The survey that they initially went out to the police dispatchers, and there was no response or a negative response on that. So instead of police dispatchers, they went out to the firemen, and they got a more positive response. They sent out surveys to the townships asking if they would be interested. Surveys, many of the towns said yes, they would be interested, but they did not go back to their committees or their councils to seek permission. There was nothing formal about what was done at all.
Exactly.
So there was no general agreement as far as, and we have discussed that. I've discussed it at the administrators' meeting, and there are many, many people that don't feel they've signed up. We haven't gone through the process. All the figures have been mentioned about cost and lack of cost, and I certainly agree with it. But I also question the fundamental premise, and the fundamental premise is that if we combine all these various townships, that we'll get a more efficient and less costly product. And let me tell you, that is not always true. If that were true, then New York City would have the best-run, most efficient public school system in the country. It doesn't work that way for a number of reasons. We've worked very hard on this dispatch center. We have a brand new center upstairs. We have people that we have selected very carefully. They know the township, they know the policemen, and they give us good service. And from what we heard there, we don't know what would happen to our people. So they have to do a much better job of coming up with costs. And I'd like to see, actually, to come up with a cost figure that allows towns, that if a town doesn't save money, then they're not expected to join this. You have to be shown where you can save some money. And if you don't save money, then you don't join it. There are some towns that could benefit, I think, and perhaps they should join it. But maybe it should be scaled such that people can move in when they feel that it is an advantage to it. But right now there isn't, and I certainly don't see any reason for us to jump in.
Well, I reached out to Dr. Kesselman and had a lengthy conversation with him, and Of course, I think the reason that they chose that site is because the land was being donated. It was on Pomona Road and Door Street. And of course, as mentioned here by Rodney and Amy, and it was a nice building. It's a three-story building, but why do you have to build a building that big? They don't really need a new police department there. They don't need a new police building. That was what Harvey told me, but it's part of this plan, and of course, they will go along with it. But he said they're not pushing it from their side. I think the other point that you have to look at is the fact that they're going to hire 130 dispatchers. That's going to be a mammoth type of an operation. I'm sure, Mike, you would agree to that, just with your experience. And of course, the quality of people that they're hiring in, they're going to hire them in at $28,000 a year. Now, if my math is correct, that comes to about $13.46 an hour. I mean, that's kind of low standard. I mean, I think, and I don't want to demean any businesses by saying you could be doing that at maybe McDonald's or Walmart, and it's not meant to demean anybody by making that statement. But I think the people that work in dispatch are a well-informed group of people who know how to handle pressure. They know what immediate response is necessary. They know the questions they ask. And if you look at what we spent on our dispatch center, and of course we can brag about it because we have a state-of-the-art center in there, and people said, well, why did you do that? Well, while everybody's waiting for everybody else to act, we already did act. We acted several years ago, and we upgraded everything. And I think from that particular point of view, there's a lot hanging in the balance here. Now, the county said, we'll buy your equipment. That doesn't solve the problem. That's the least of your problem. The problem is, I think, a lot of the things that Amy said. Phase in, how would you phase it in? And in the meantime, while you're phasing it in, what happens to turnover? What happens to people you're going to hire? I think there's too many unanswered questions, and I don't know whether we'll get all of them answered tomorrow night. I think at very least, they may come to the point where we don't have enough information. We're going to put this on the back shelf and look at it at another time because we want to wait till the things in Atlantic City iron out. I think we're still reeling from an anticipated tax bill in 2016 because last year we didn't get hit with a high number because everything wasn't in for Atlantic City, but that's still going to be a big number this year. And again, you know, we care about our residents. We care about the fact that many of them are struggling to keep their homes. Not every home that's on in the foreclosure list in the sheriff's sales is one of ours, but sometimes they are. And I think one only has to drive around the community to see that. So there's a lot that comes into play in this, and I just hope that as a committee, and we're on board and understanding when we make that decision, how delicate it's going to be and how challenging it's going to be. So to all of you up here, you're certainly invited to that meeting, and you're welcome to be there. And of course, I think you should be if you can make it. I know it's a difficult time this year, this time of the season, but I would suggest everybody make it if you can. I didn't want to open this up to the public because we'll wait till the meeting, and then we'll give you a recap on it at the next meeting. And obviously, maybe you'll read a lot more about it in a newspaper. And again, we'll see where it goes. Does anybody else on committee have anything? Judy, you all right?
Yes. I don't think, maybe I missed it, but what are they going to charge us if we don't, get involved in this? What is there a...
We would still get the same
as everybody
the tax
else.
Rate that they would strike. We would get whatever the equalized value is to us.
Okay, so we would still have our, well, then we would have to disperse our system.
It right? could cost us a well, couple cents on a couple cents on the budget. It could be 2, it could be 3 cents. We're not sure the exact number, but if for one reason you just said, what if we said, no, we're not going to do it, we're going to stay with our own, it's going to have penalties.
And it opens up a whole nother door because the way they are alleging that they're going to handle the money, and Mike, you can correct me if I'm wrong, they're going to take the expense of it. How Mike say it? They're going to
they will reduce our budget cap,
right,
in an equal amount, so you won't have room in your budget to run your own dispatch,
right?
The county's budget will go up that same amount, and ours will go down. So you wouldn't be able to maintain our own dispatch if it goes forward.
Well, we would, but we'd have to maybe cut something else to accommodate it.
Yeah.
We wouldn't have the room in the budget, so we'd have to make the room if we wanted to stay in that direction.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the other thing that you mentioned about best practices, for those that, what he's talking about, the utility tax receipts, which used to belong to each municipality every year, which run into the millions in some communities, the state thought that they could handle it a lot better than we could have. So what they do in order to us get back our share of it, we have to do certain things. Shared services, do other type of things like that. And if you don't do it, they penalize you, and you could lose 5%, 10% of it. And over time, they're going to find a way to take it all away from us anyhow, especially when they started with this cap, 4%, now it's 2%. So we're pretty much controlled when we do our budgets. And if you want to exceed it, you have a long way to go to try to do it. So in many ways, and I've often said it, one thing I'll leave you with. Amy mentioned, since we've been on committee 8 years, the county budget has increased from $176 million to $201.1 million. That's $25.1 million. That's the exact size of our budget, $25.1 million. And our budget has come down from $27 million down to $25. So when you look at it, all you're really doing is they're increasing their expenditures. And if they tell you, you know, they're well run, that's fine and well, and I don't argue that with them, but you can't keep expanding what you do and expect your budget to come down. And the only way you can do it is if you take it away from your employees, if you take some programs and you do away with them. The county's got a lot of issues they've got to face, and I'm not here to criticize them, but we're also in partners here. And if we're going to be in partners, then we have to look for each other to do the right thing and be judicious the way we spend taxpayers' money.
In reference to us keeping our own system, is there are too many small paper roads or roads that are not identified readily. And, you know, you might have someone responding like in an hour, and they should have been there 15 minutes ago, or, you know. I just don't have the confidence that passing on this responsibility to someone else, that they will be caring about their community, knowing about their community, et cetera. I think it has to do with people's service and safety more than anything else.
And that's the exact other side of what our argument has been, right, Judy. Aside from the money, you couldn't have said it any better. You know, that other side of the knowing our town, the familiarity, not only with the town, but with the people. You know, I'm looking at everybody who's sitting over there. I see some of our fire chiefs, our police officers, our dispatchers, our employees. They all work together.
Yeah.
Whether it's to, you know, help get to an incident or to resolve crimes. They work together because they have that inherent knowledge that you're mentioning. And that's why... that was one of the reasons why we've been in a huge objector, is not to lose that. But the other side of it is, if they're not even going to hire our people, that none of that knowledge is going in.
Exactly.
You know, and that's a whole nother ball, yeah, of wax, you know.
Exactly.
Well, you know, Mayor Guardian told me last week when I met him at the League of Municipalities convention, he said, I have 65 dispatchers. Do you think a new dispatcher knows where an alley is, an alleyway in Atlantic City? It's the same thing you're talking about, Judy.
Yeah.
The
Liling
Lane. The mailbox to identify a property. And that those points have to be well taken and thought of.
Yeah, I'd like to. I have an idea, and I don't know whether this can be done. The lawyers would probably tell me it can't. But the way this should proceed is if they make cost estimates for 5 years in the future. If a particular municipality does not save money, or it does not at least lose money over that five-year period, then they should not be required to join. And if they don't join, then they shouldn't be taxed. Now, I don't know, they'd probably say it's not possible. I think it could probably be worked out, but there is an obligation. Municipalities should be held harmless. We should not be forced to join in this and end up paying more money.
Yeah, but so, I think the way they've planned is it's all in or nothing.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's all
that's
in or nothing.
That's the way it is.
Well, the plan needs to be changed.
Your plan.
We've also suggested the idea of, instead of one central place, you know, why don't you have Hamilton, Galloway, EHT, and Atlantic City be kind of four major centers, so that you can back each other up, the smaller towns can fold in, people can find those savings, you know, we can keep some of the inherent knowledge in each of the major areas, you know, still potentially achieve the savings, but not create this whole new arm of government. You know, we've suggested that. It hasn't gotten much traction or discussion, but I think your point is another great suggestion, Rodney. But the discussion with them has consistently been, it's all or nothing.
I agree with the rest of the committee. This is something that we really need to look into more. There's just too many questions, numbers that don't add up. And we're sitting fortunate to be here with a state-of-the-art, professionally staffed dispatch center that we're all proud of. So we're in a position here to kind of hold out to see how things transpire.
Okay, with that in mind, and we'll be at the meeting tomorrow night. Hopefully we'll have, we definitely will have an update at the 21st meeting. And in the meantime, I thank you, committee, for all your input, and I look forward to seeing you there tomorrow night.
It's a shame they scheduled a meeting on a Friday for the following Tuesday.
I know.
So that many of us can't make it.
Right.
But you'll be there in spirit.
Oh, yeah.
All right, the next item on the agenda is the American Legion Building Redevelopment Update from the ACIS.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Township committee members have copied the memo I received on November 17th from Bob McGuigan at the Improvement Authority. And just to take a step back, you will recall that earlier this summer we were successful in being awarded a grant from the Improvement Authority to undertake a redevelopment study specifically of the American Legion building, site-specific redevelopment plan. This is a program where the ACIA is paying for it. They issued the RFPs, they solicited the professionals, they've gone through that process. As indicated, first off, to do the study, they've selected Tiffany Coviello. She's a sole practitioner. Tiffany's a former township resident. She's currently the part-time, she's a planner in Galloway Township, plus she has her own consulting business on the side. She's very well qualified to do the work. Secondly, and more importantly, why I brought this to your attention is that the ACIA has added a provision now that if we were to sell the building,
yes,
at some time in the future, they would want to recoup the cost for them doing this study. That wasn't in the original proposal when it was submitted. That's something I wanted to bring to your attention. If we want to continue going forward, or if you say, you know something, it's not worth it. There's you know, two ways you can look at it. The plan will create a value for the structure. Mm-hmm. It's, as a redevelopment area, the governing body has the right to negotiate the sale. And if it's sold, then it gets on the tax roll, so we'll be getting some money out of the building no matter what.
Absolutely.
And you set the price.
Yeah.
Sure. So if the Improvement Authority spends, I will just throw out $20,000 just as an example to do this work, and you turn around and you sell the building for a dollar, that's what they get. If you sell it for $10,000, that's what they would get out of it. But you know, it's not an all or nothing sort of thing.
Yeah, right. That's good.
Again,
that's
reasonable. Since it's a change, it's a change in their strategy, a change in their agreement. I just wanted you to be aware of it, and if you objected to it, I'd let them know also and say thanks, but no thanks.
And it saves demolition of a historic quality building.
Yeah. Just curious, is it their practice to change like that after the fact?
I believe in talking to the staff there, what occurred is they chose three locations. And one of which I think is in Egg Harbor City. It's evidently a substantial size property that the city owns and are looking to redevelop and clearly sell. And the amount that they would recoup would clearly exceed this. So I think that sort of triggered the need to put this in there.
Still after the fact.
Yes. it's nice to know these sort of things up front.
Thank you, Phil. Anything else?
That's it.
Thank you. Okay. Next item on the agenda, C, authorization to sell the replaced Cologne Fire Department, a 1989 Pierce Arrow 1,000-gallon water pumper to South Jersey Transportation Authority for $5,000. It's fixed asset number 228.
Do you want to...
Mike, do you want to...
Yes, sir. We were approached by the, the chief called first, and our, actually, the Cologne Fire Chief called us first. He had a conversation with the fire chief for the South Jersey Transportation Authority, and they asked us if we'd be interested in selling it. We arrived at the price because that's the highest bid we received when we had it on GovDeals, and we've had it on there several times. So, seemed like a reasonable transaction, and it gets good use of a vehicle with still has a value. So, I'm recommending it. I've talked to our attorney about it, and also our purchasing agent, so we're good to do it.
Make a motion to authorize that sale.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Mrs. Anderson, can we have a roll call, please?
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
I'm going to abstain because I work part-time out at the airport for the SJTA.
Four yeses and one abstain. It's carried.
Thank you. Item D, changing $49,850 funding source for the Leapy Complex Football Field Scoreboard from Bond Ordinance 1787-2015 to Offsite Improvements Recreation Trust Fund Reserve T22-56-850-001-855. Now, that's a mouthful.
Wow.
So instead of bonding for it, we're using the trust money?
That's what we are.
Using the trust money. Yeah.
Are we going to use the bond money for anything else?
Other recreation programs.
Okay, good.
There's more latitude in bond money use than there is in the trust fund use.
Yeah.
So and this fits the trust fund use.
Perfect.
How much is left in the trust fund after that?
Well, there was $79,300, so about 20-something.
Okay. Was that seconded?
I'll make the motion.
You second it?
No.
Motion and a second. Questions or comments? Roll call, Mrs. Anderson.
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
Thank you. Okay. Now we have the... Item E, the Municipal Alliance Program. Would you step up to the mic and as we speak about this, Mike, go ahead. Would you start it off?
Yes. The Municipal Alliance is actually, we run it through the County Alliance Program, and we received a letter from Charles Curley, who is the Atlantic County Alliance Coordinator, recommending that we do not run a program this year and instead use this year's to rebuild our volunteer board and to get it up and running again, because we don't have enough volunteers. So we received that letter. We've had contact from Catalana, that, you know, she might be interested in helping spearhead getting it going again. That would be great, so we don't have to miss a year, but we would need a commitment of
Well, I think the hope
volunteers.
Is, you know, to get the necessary number of volunteers so that we can keep this program alive. And you're going to need at least six, I believe. So go ahead. You want to introduce yourself and
yeah.
be my guest?
I'm Lisa Catalano. And in addition to myself, there's Kathy, who is willing to be a part of the Alliance. And
Jersey Shore Children's Museum.
Okay.
And also I have three other people: Michael Braxton, he's an Atlantic City police officer who lives in Mays Landing, Tiffany Turney, and Monique Cohen. So we already have five of us, and I think it will be easy to get more.
Michael?
Okay.
Will you reach out to Michael? And
now, Lisa, I don't mean to put the pressure on.
There is.
But the big question here is leadership. And so somebody among, I won't say it has to be you, even though you would do great. Somebody in that group of people, I mean, somebody's going to have to step up as the coordinator.
The chairman, right.
And a chairman. And a chairman.
And chairman.
Two positions.
It's a very high-paying position, FYI.
Hello, minimum.
You know, I don't know, Mike, what we have from a timeline perspective, but, you know, I just wonder if we should, and I love Lisa's passion. I know Lisa. I know she'll rally these troops. But I just wonder if we need to have like a check-in time to say, are we on course with whatever we need to be doing so that nothing is left floundering or loose ends are not tied or anything?
Well, it runs from July to June. I don't know if Susan's here. I don't know if she knows when we would need some commitments by.
I think January 29th, we have to reapply for the 2017 funds. Is that correct?
I'm sorry, what date did you say?
January 29th.
Right. We need to start the process of next year's fiscal budget.
Now.
So we need to make a decision quickly.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
How quick you think you could at least get everyone together? Would you be ready to start at least by January?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
Does that work, Sue?
Yes. And I will be willing to help them transition in. I'm actually the coordinator now. I took over that position because we
voluntarily
lost the prior coordinator. Yes. So I would be willing to help them.
Great. Thank you.
That's great.
So I'd say then if we kind of have like a, maybe you guys could get together, put together like a 30-day transition plan or plan of action, and we check back in at maybe the second meeting in January just to kind of make sure everybody's good and we're good to go.
Okay.
And just curious, I haven't met you, obviously, but what's the motivation? Why are you interested in doing this?
I work in substance abuse prevention programs, evidence-based ones, and I do most of my programs in Atlantic City and Pleasantville because that's where we're grant-funded, but I believe in the prevention programs, and I think that the students here in Hamilton could benefit. So I don't want to see that money go away. And I know the governor's council gives out the money and it's there. Why not use it?
Okay.
I'm hoping to find someone to coordinate because I do not choose to do that. But I would if I needed to. But I'm hoping in this time that I'll find somebody to do that. I would chair the meetings, but I don't necessarily want to be the coordinator.
Well, it's great to see someone step forward with the enthusiasm to make this go. Yes, absolutely.
So, Michael?
Is the point right now that you have five and you need six?
I have the sixth. Yes, she contacted me. It's Karen Waltman, I believe her name is, and she's already been within the Municipal Alliance, and she's very
great.
Active with Project Graduation. So she
and that's
wants
another
to.
Great program.
Right, absolutely. Yeah. Okay. Perfect.
Yeah. So, I'm sorry.
There has to be another person.
Very much.
Wow, that's awesome.
Would you, Mike, reach out to Michael? Give her your card, Mike, or just your address there, the phone number, and then get it going. If there's anything you need from us, I'm available during the week. I could be in a meeting too, okay?
Do we need to make a motion to either table the recommendation or decline it at this point from the letter we received, or we don't have to?
I don't think so. I think
okay.
We can just leave it
just
open.
Just move ahead with it.
Yeah. See what kind of progress we.
First of all, ladies, thank you.
Thank you.
You're a rare find in this day and age.
thank you.
We thank you, and we thank you for the trying to keep the programs in our community that are beneficial alive. Thank you.
Certainly do. Thank you.
And Lisa, I know your daughter's sitting there and she's smiling. So I think number one, you should know that you're setting such a great example. And I hope she knows how awesome you are and is proud of you. And if not, letting you know that we're very proud of your mommy right now.
Here you go. Look at a big smile on her face.
I just wanted to say, too, that Charlie Curley, the Alliance coordinator, knows that I was attending tonight and is in full support if we think this can be done of it. Us reapplying for the grant.
Perfect.
Oh, very good. Thank you.
Thanks, ladies.
Lisa. Appreciate you.
So, does that mean we contribute $3,800 to this program?
Not until they get the grant, yeah.
Not until they get the grant?
Right.
Okay.
Okay.
That's good.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, Lise.
Okay, the next item on the list, it's yours, Rodney. South Jersey Transportation Planning Organization Process and Problem Statements.
Yes, I think many of you, maybe all of you know that over the past years there have been certain areas within the township where we've had a continual traffic problems, and we have brought this out on many occasions. More recently, we got a committee together, I guess it was a couple of months ago, including the engineer, the police department, the administrator, and a couple of others, to identify what the worst roads are, what the roads are that we have the greatest concern for. The idea was, and I think I've mentioned before, that the federal government provides this transportation funds, and they have a process through which these funds are supposed to be dispersed. And it's a fairly substantial amount of money. It goes to the state, and then from the state, it comes down to what are called MPOs. And the South Jersey Transportation Authority is one of the administrators of this money. They also require that a Citizens Advisory Committee be formed as part of this. And the purpose of that Citizens Advisory Committee is obviously to get information from citizens to make sure that's taken into account. So I'm a member of that Citizens Advisory Committee, and you have the chairman is Bob Campbell, who's also from Atlantic County. There are 13 members, there are four counties involved, so it's all the counties in Southern Jersey. And ultimately, there's a transportation plan, improvement plan put together, and there's quite a bit of money involved in that. So the idea was to identify our key transportation problem areas, put them down, submit them through this process to get something done about it. Well, that was done, and the response got back was that we needed to prepare problem statements. I was a little somewhat disappointed at that because I was hoping that we could hand them our best layman's input, and then they would do the engineering, the technical work associated with coming up with the solutions. But we got these problem statements, and our administrator received them, and he handed it off to our engineer. And we subsequently received estimates for what it would take to complete the problem statements. And I think the figure was somewhere in the area of $8,000. Is that right?
$8,600.
Now, if in fact this helps us get these road problems fixed, it would be a tremendous plus. But I don't. This is still a new process, and I really can't say. But in any event, they are our problems, and we do, I think, would help us to define as well as we can the extent of the problem. Now, we have a choice here. Either we can go ahead and have these have the problem statements filled out in a professional manner, or we could try to do as best we can with our staff here. And I know the administrator and certainly the staff probably feels that they're already strapped and that would be difficult. So I guess the committee needs to make a decision as to what we want to do here. Now, I must say that some of these problems have been identified before, and we've gone through various routes to get them completed. I think more recently we had Chris Brown involved.
He's holding a packet, Rod.
Right.
Almost all the roadways you're talking about here that have gone to Assemblyman Brown and Whalen.
Yep.
And we even had somebody from the state out at the fairways 3 months ago who promised that they were going to get some of the work done. And when they left the meeting, they went back to Trenton and they retired.
Yeah.
The next thing I know, I get a letter from the person that replaced them stating that, could you please contact me and give me an update on what the problem areas are?
Yeah.
And I wrote them back in so many words that you have all the information. Don't contact me unless you're ready to proceed with the work that has to be done. Now, some of the work that you're talking about has been done.
Right, and some of them places.
Some of it. Now, this group that you belong to is part of the SJTA?
TPO. Don't they have any money? The Citizens Advisory Committee has no money.
No, but the group you are, Tim.
Well, that's who administers, more or less, the federal money that comes through the area. So that's the reason for going to that.
A lot of them are state and county roadways. So
that's right.
So I think they're, for us and even though they're in our municipality, we have our hands full taking care of our roadways and just getting attention on some of the others. Look how long we've been waiting and Amy's been the lead on that, to try to get some attention on Route 50 with all the fatalities there, right, Amy?
Oh, yeah.
That's right, and we wrote up, I think we wrote up a pretty decent package.
7 years on that already?
Police and others and helped write up a pretty good package on that.
Sure they did. And, I don't know, Ronnie, I just don't know at this point, and obviously you can't take it out of capital, and of course our regular budget is coming to an end right now, and I think, how much time do you have on these? The only thing I would tell you at this point, maybe, as we get into budget discussions, there may or there may not be a possibility we can look at that for the first quarter of next year.
And there's a couple of these on here that are being looked at already through the improvement of the project, Conifer project, specifically Route 40 and New York Avenue and Cologne and 322.
And I must say, they've been looked at for a long time.
Sure.
So what we're trying to do is just use every vehicle we can to get some focus on these things and get something done, because there are very serious traffic problems. And by the way, we've submitted some excellent ideas before. And we have some others that can be submitted to help get this thing moving. But we need to do everything we can to get it moving, because otherwise it's just not going to happen.
I mean, so first of all, I don't think Lake Lenape Dam should be on here, because that's not a traffic problem, nor do we own it.
That was put there because apparently, at least the feeling was, that this group through the SJTPO does have the authority to look at that. And whether that turns out to be true or not, I think this is still relatively new.
I my opinion on this, Rodney, and I understand the work you're doing and I appreciate it. I think it would be wasted money, wasted effort, based on the amount of effort and time that we've already made trying to get attention. Most of these are state or county roadways that we maybe intersect with. That have gotten no attention. I'd rather spend $8,600 to try to bump up our place in line on trying to get the freaking parking signs approved on Main Street, because it's a state roadway where we just want to show people where they can freaking park, to spend money at our businesses. If we can cross one thing off the list, I would love to do that.
I agree.
So I just don't have an appetite. I think, honestly, it would be a waste to spend money on writing statements that I'd be happy to help with trying to do voluntarily. Maybe there's other people out there who are interested in trying to help do that voluntarily, but I think we could spend $8,600 a little bit more wisely.
Well, I will explore this a little more. I would not want to throw this opportunity away. It is a resource, and I'd like to take advantage of it. So I'll see if I can get some more definitiveness on exactly what's required and what we can do in-house. But I do. But I think it would be inappropriate to throw this opportunity away.
We may be able, if we can get them together now that the election is over, to sit down with Assemblyman Brown and Mazzio,
yeah,
and talk to them about some of these.
We can do that, too. We can do whatever we can, and we need to get some of these problems fixed.
Good. Thank you.
Do you think we could have either one of them here as a guest to talk about?
I don't know if you'd get them a guest in front of everybody, but I think if you got them in a room and show them all the paperwork that they've been pushing back and forth and make them realize that it's been a wasted effort because nothing has happened. And how often and how long are we going to study these things? You know, I hear you. You know, there's things that are going to happen on McKee Avenue. There's things that are taking place in a business venture that may change the complex of that.
Well, and that's one of the things they're saying, that they don't want to do anything until that matures, but who knows when that's going to happen?
No, I hear you. I hear you.
Rodney, this might be like a shot in the dark, but do we attempt to engage either students at Oakcrest or at ACIT or maybe an engineering-type magnet program who might be interested in a service learning and actually using the data that we have to develop problem statements, and they get the benefit of learning on that process and we get the benefit of the problem statement out of it? It's just an idea.
Well, sounds good to me.
Yeah,
does sound good.
We don't want to beat you out of any money, Bob. But you understand.
Sorry, Bob, but
you're busy. You're busy.
Yeah.
I like
beating you out of money.
Keep it in the back of our minds. Do what you can. Will any of us come up with anything more concrete?
I will explore the area, including getting our two assemblymen
Please.
Here after we have enough data and you know, have something substantial to discuss with them.
Thank you.
That's great.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is item number 6, public hearing or adoption ordinances. A, 1803-2015, amending Exhibit A, Section 1, Article 2 of Chapter 66 of the Township Code, providing for maximum number of employees. Now, Michael, this was introduced at the last meeting. That's just the addition of that one person to the overall list?
Yeah, it doesn't add a person. It's just, it deletes, it adds and deletes. It creates an accounts payable purchasing position with a maximum, not a starting salary, but a maximum salary of $40,000.
Okay, good. This is a public hearing. Does anyone in the public wish to speak on this?
Move to close the public portion.
Second.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Move to adopt.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Mrs. Anderson.
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gouchard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silver?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
Thank you. Item B, 1804-2015, adoption of a redevelopment plan for the Mays Landing Historic District area in need of rehabilitation.
Mr. Mayor, as a result of a meeting that was conducted with the administration and with my office, there have been what I consider to be substantial changes in the document that was introduced at the last meeting. Those changes are in the form that you have before you now. On the form of ordinance that was in my packet earlier, it has its dated October, but Mrs. Anderson has provided an update to that. The revisions are dated December of 2015. So because of the nature of the changes, it would require reintroduction tonight with an adoption hearing on the 21st.
Okay.
Okay.
Do you need us to make a motion to do that?
To introduce, yeah.
Okay, motion to reintroduce ordinance 1804-2015 with the date change to December 2015 rather than October 2015.
Second.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
And just that newly revised presentation is available on our website now?
It will be.
Okay, perfect. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thanks,
Phil. That's the rehabilitation downtown plan for anybody who's interested. Right. You'll be able to get an updated copy of that on our website.
Yeah, item number seven, land
most
sales.
Important.
Accept bid of $5,000 offered by Jack Firstput Jr. and Jack First.
Somebody in here running this.
What?
What's this public hearing?
21st of December.
Yeah, because we reintroduced it, Jim, because of the changes.
For lots 14 and 15 in block 667. At December 3rd, 2015, public land sale.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Can we have a vote, Mrs. Anderson?
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gouchard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
B, accept a bid of $3,500 offered by David Schwenker for lots 2, 3, 20, 21, and 27 in block 100 at the December 3rd, 2015 public land sale.
So moved.
Moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Vote, please, Mrs.
Okay, Anderson. I heard Mr. Kurtz make the motion. Who seconded it?
I seconded.
Thank you.
Second.
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gouchard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
C, final ratification of land sale to Constant D. Prather pursuant to ordinance 1798-2015.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Vote, Mrs. Anderson.
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gouchard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes. D,
yes and carried.
Authorized preparation of continuous owner land sale ordinance for lots 23, 24, and 25 in block 100, 3 acres on Market Street, RD4 zone, minimum bid $1,500.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Roll call.
Oh, you want a roll call? You
roll
got
call.
It.
Okay.
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gouchard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
E, authorized the preparation of continuous owner land sale ordinance for lots 5 and block 41-70.76 acres on a Blackhurst Pike, HC zone, minimum bid $1,500.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Vote, Mrs. Anderson.
Ms. Scatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Ms. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
Okay.
Mayor, before we move on, Mike, do you just want to explain to the public the benefit of these land sales to us?
Yes, over the years, the town has taken ownership of various vacant parcels of ground and for non-payment of taxes. We foreclose on it. And we started a program of trying to notify some abutting property owners that this land's available, and some of them are taking us up on it, and we're basically selling the land. We get a few dollars for the land, but most importantly, we get it back on the tax rolls.
Right.
So we get the annual taxes as well. So, yep. And they get used to the property.
Yep. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike. Okay, consent agenda. I want to pull before we go to it B, K, and T.
B, A, and C.
Make a motion to. What? I didn't.
B, K, and T.
Make a motion to approve consent agenda A through F minus B, K, and T, and including the four names of businesses that are on the late addition that are listed under 10A, but I think were meant for 8A.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Any questions or comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Just a quick comment on that letter R that we just approved asks for any posting or any submission of applications for any of our boards and commissions in preparation for our January reorganization.
Right.
Posting a deadline of December 21st. The application's available on our website. You can also come into Town Hall here if you'd like to volunteer and get involved on any of our boards and commissions. We do always accept applications on a rolling basis, but we're just kind of trying to put a line in the sand so that we can see who's interested as we get ready for reorg. So just want to highlight that date.
Thank you. Okay, I pulled out B because it's to authorize the release of $918,782.40 Citibank letter of credit number 696-01-01916, performance guarantee for Craftco Company, LLC Stormwater Management Basin Remediation Project, as recommended by Stephen L. Philippone, Township Engineer for the project, on November 19, 2015. I just wanted you to know what the amount of that was, and I wanted a vote on it.
Doesn't that require the posting of a maintenance guarantee as a condition preceding to release? Yes. So that should be made part of the motion.
That they post a maintenance guarantee?
Yes.
You're right with that, Phil? Yeah.
Okay. You have Mr. Philippone in the audience.
Yep.
Yeah. So what's the language got to be?
That once that we release this, but they'll have to post a maintenance guarantee, right?
As a condition precedent to releasing the letter of credit,
they have
a
to
maintenance
post.
Bond would have to be posted consistent with the ordinance.
I make that motion.
I'll second.
Second.
Knowing that, any questions or comments? Mrs. Anderson.
Yes, Mr. Philippone, will you send me an email of what the maintenance guarantee has to be, the amount? Thank you. Ms. Scatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
I think it's worth noting, Mayor, the work that not only Steve has done for us, but that Craftco, which is the mall, has really done as a partner to make sure that, you know, from a stormwater perspective, we've kind of got everything back to where it needs to be, but just being a great partner in town and doing the right thing. So I just
you did a great job there.
Yeah, absolutely. They worked a lot on the basin problem, and it's you can see it when you go by that the work is fruitful. It really is working.
Yeah. Thank
you.
If only the state had done the same thing.
Yeah.
They were a pleasure to work with, and they were very committed to the township. And like I said, they're a pleasure to deal with.
Great.
Thanks, Steve.
Thank you. Okay, Kay, I pulled that out because it's approved the 2016 shared service agreement with the Police Activities League, PAL, for the use of the Frank Greco Center.
Carol was here.
Okay. Carol, you're in the audience. Did you want to say anything about that? Come on up to the mic. Yeah, just.
I'd rather not go to the mic. I was just hoping to say thank you with this.
Well, you've can, but let me say this to you. If any of you realize what goes on over there and how well this shared services worked with PAL, you'll understand why we're putting it back on the agenda to approve everything they do there. And also, if anybody else communicates with them that wants to use the building, am I correct? Just check with you and you work things out for them, correct?
And there are stipulations in place with the agreement that was drawn up, but if there was something that we could accommodate with...
Good.
Yeah, I think Carol and everybody does such a great job with the programs.
Yes, they do.
And really bringing the maximum use of that building, and it's really been a really positive relationship, so thank you, Carol, for all the work that you and everyone does. Make a motion to approve that agreement.
Second.
Discussion on the motion?
I'd like to just, if you could forward a schedule as to when you are using the building, you know, so that we
just forward it to Mr. Jacobs, Carol.
Yeah.
Send him an email on it, okay?
I just have one question, Mr. Mayor. Who's in charge of making sure this certificate of insurance gets submitted?
Repeat the question?
Who's in charge of making sure the...
Our JIF coordinator.
Lisa, thank you.
You're in good hands.
Yes.
You don't work for Allstate, but you're in good hands, okay? All right. Can we get a voice vote on that, Mrs. Anderson?
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
You're welcome, Carol. Okay. T, approve the change order to the 2014 Milling and Patching Program contract. The adjusted total is $177,624. I just wanted to avoid a vote on that when everybody makes the motion.
Oh, make a motion.
Second.
Motion is second. Mrs. Anderson?
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and
Thank
carried.
You. Nine, personnel. Accept the resignation of George Samuelson, Jr., Zoning Board of Adjustment, regular member effective November the 22nd, 2015. The term expires December the 31st, 2016.
Well, I begrudgingly will make a motion to accept. George has been a great asset on there, but I understand he has some new job responsibilities that are preventing him from being able to serve the way he would like to serve. So hopefully one of these days we'll get him back, but I'll make that motion.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Mike, would you send him a letter, please, thanking him for his service? B, rescind the November the 19th, 2015 appointment of Matthew Borowski as a part-time special law enforcement officer, class 2. I understand what? He got hired full-time somewhere?
Took a job somewhere else.
Okay.
Make that motion.
Second.
Motion is second. Question or comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
Roll call, please.
Roll call.
Roll call.
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
Oh, yes.
C, appoint Kanacher Anderson to a full-time temporary labor at $15 per hour effective December 9th, 2015.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Motion is second. Okay. Questions or comments? A vote, Mrs. Anderson.
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Kishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
D, appoint Helen Steno, a temporary part-time clerk in the tax collection department at $14.41 per hour on an as-needed basis.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Mrs. Anderson.
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
E, appoint Jeremy Robinson as a temporary part-time violations clerk at $14.41 per hour effective December 9th, 2015.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Mrs. Anderson.
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
F, approve the transfer of Brenda Junker at to regular part-time violations clerk at $14.41 an hour per hour effective retroactive November 18th, 2015.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Mrs. Anderson?
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gishard? Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
Thank you. Approvals, November 9th, 2015, regular meeting minutes.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. B was deleted. C, payroll and bills totaling $1,817,240.46.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Mrs. Anderson?
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
Thank you. Reports, Mr. Administrator?
I don't have anything to add to my written report.
Okay. Mr. Solicitor?
Nothing.
Okay. Mr. Engineer?
I'm going to break tradition a little bit.
Oh, that's quite all right.
All right.
We're not upset. Thank you.
I just wanted to comment a little bit about the Park Road ongoing construction.
Thank you.
The contractor who's been doing the concrete curb work has been trying to work as best he could with the residents. We've been touching base with them, trying to make sure they get access in and out. We've had some snafus, but for the most part, they're being very accommodating for the residents. They did the reclamation of a portion of the road today from the bridge to Rundle. They intend on grading tomorrow and Wednesday, anticipating paving either Thursday or Friday from the bridge to Rundle Avenue. So everything that everyone sees today as subgrade material should be paved by the end of this week, which is good because we have very favorable weather. But I do want to indicate that there will be some times when they're doing the grading and paving that access is going to be somewhat limited to the homes. We just ask that the residents bear with us as we make the improvements to Park Road. And if anyone has any questions, problems with access, and they don't get satisfaction from the contractor, they can call my office directly at any time. And I've been spending actually quite a bit of time out on Park Road trying to address the residents' concerns. So we're moving forward. We'll have a good portion of it paved by the end of this week. And going forward, as long as the weather holds out, we'll get the second half of the roadway paved before the end of the paving season.
Good. Okay. Thank you, Bob.
Thanks, Mayor.
Good.
Township committee members, Judy?
Yeah, I think Robert is doing an excellent job on the on Park Road, helping people, you know, get in and out of their homes and knowing what is happening. It's a good thing. And doing a professional job otherwise on the curbing and making sure everything is going along as scheduled. I think you said there was 400 feet per day.
Yeah, the contractor's getting approximately 400 feet of curb per day.
Yeah, which is very good, considering that this time of the year is a very iffy time. And thank goodness there is a lot of good weather our way. So I did hear a comment about the weather turning and what we would be left with if it wasn't. So that's a very good thing. I attended the Dickens of the Holiday, and our senior advisory committee handed out approximately 100 brochures about different ways in which seniors can save money, get accommodations for transportation, and so on and so forth. I was very proud of this group. They've only met twice. And, you know, this was a wonderful little pamphlet. It's only the beginning of their efforts to really communicate to the seniors of our community and really get them on board with the things available. And that's all I have to say. Oh, yes. I got my earrings from the Crafty Cricket, you know, these big Christmas trees on my ear. They were three young ladies starting a new business, and it was really nice to see them at the Dickens of the Holiday. And I was thinking, gee, wouldn't it be great if we could attract some of those people that are, you know, showing their crafts, is to move them into a place on Main Street, get them interested in, you know, investing in that. So that was my idea. I'm sure John has probably did that himself numerous times. So it would be good. There was great crafts that were displayed in the library and in Presbyterian Church, and of course in a Memorial Park. They had great things for the children. They really love seeing Santa there. They love the rides, and you know, as I say, there were things that we could really buy, which were nice.
Thank you, Terry. John?
I just want to back Judy up on that a little bit. Arlene's here today with the Merchants Association. That's the last event that the Merchants Association puts on for the year. Who knew on December 5th that the temperature would be almost 60 degrees and a beautiful day? It was great. We probably had one of the largest crowds we've ever had at the park. And they also went around town to visit the library craft location and also at the Presbyterian Church. But even the breakfast with Santa at the Masonic Lodge was incredible. The Masonic Lodge staff got back to the merchants to tell them that it was the most successful breakfast ever held that they've had, including any of their breakfasts. So it was pictures with Mr. and Mrs. Santa at 8 o'clock in the morning till 11. Again, it was mobbed, and it was very professionally done. It was a great, great job. And even in the park, it looked great. And of course, with the work that Public Works did on the decorations this year, it's absolutely fantastic. And what a way to showcase our city to our residents. There were no of any kind. We had no problems. It went very well. And I think that with the senior advisory board members being there the first time to hand out the literature was a great plus, too. I thought that was great. But kudos to the Merchants Association. Thank you.
Thank you.
I was just going to add something. We had nice signs for parking. Hint, 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 county, state. It is very important that we point out where our parking is. So I know it's been an ongoing problem.
Rodney?
Yeah, I just certainly want to reinforce the comments that were just made by John Kurtz and others regarding Dickens of a Holiday. I came late. Unfortunately, I couldn't hear the whole thing, but I brought my granddaughter, my 2 3/4-year-old granddaughter, and she just had a ball. And it was interesting that her name is Layla, and believe it or not, there were two other Laylas that we met in the brief time I was there, so that was something. And Santa Claus did such a great job that after she got off the stage, she wanted to go back and give Santa a hug, so that was fantastic.
Pictures?
I did get one picture, okay. Yeah. Yeah, it was a very nice affair, and I really want to compliment Public Works on the on the lighting. Not only was, I mean, there was art involved in that. I think they did a fantastic job, and I'm sure any of you that have seen that were impressed by it. I attended the Township Administrators meeting, and certainly the major topic of discussion there was the dispatch situation, and I think we've already discussed that. There are many people there that were unhappy with it, and I think we're going to probably see some of that at tomorrow's meeting.
Township administrators?
Yes.
Mayors.
Township administrators. The meeting of
Township officials.
Township officials.
Oh, okay. I thought you were starting to go
no,
on.
No.
Mike's professional development.
Oh, no, township officials. So. I attended the New Jersey League of Municipalities meeting, and as always, that's, what is it, 4 days, I think. It's a great meeting.
Three.
All right, 3 days. And registration, I think, is maybe. Anyway, it's a great meeting. I attended a number of the sessions. Unfortunately, I couldn't attend more, but there were a couple of really good ones. Veterans Affairs, a lot of good ideas, and the Green, the Sustainable New Jersey, had some great ideas, which I'm certainly going to talk to our group about, and they had to do with communications and some of the efforts to improve communications within municipalities that are going on around the state with some great results. Our green team is doing fantastic. We got certification, bronze level, and which is very good within just a few months, and there's a possibility of silver next year. So I think we should give our green team a hand. They've done a fantastic job, and they also were at Dickens of a Holiday over at the library. We talked about the Citizens Advisory Committee. Just let me say that it's still relatively new, and there are going to be efforts to advertise it more. So you should be hearing more about it, and hopefully we can have an impact and get some things done that need to be done in the township. One of the interesting things about campaigning is going around and talking to people in the township. And you always learn something, but it also can be rather frustrating. You have people that their expectations, first of all, so many really don't know what we do, and their expectations sometimes are very difficult to attain. I had someone sent me a letter. They didn't sign their name, but they sent a letter saying that they were not going to vote because they sent a letter here. And it wasn't answered on the TV. Now, they didn't sign their name, so they expect this to be addressed on the TV at the town hall. But they paid more for rent than people who signed up 5 years ago paid, and they feel that's discrimination, and that we should be doing something about it, and they're not voting because they didn't say.
It was.
I certainly would. There are certain things we can do and the things we can't do. And certainly when one signs an agreement with a rental, with a builder or a developer or whatever, they sign that agreement hopefully having looked around and made a decision on what the best place to go was. There's nothing that we can do to affect that contract. So I'd certainly encourage the person to give me a call if they don't find that satisfactory, but we'll be happy to talk about what we can and can't do. The other thing is, I have tried during the 3 times that I've run to not negative campaign. I have only talked about what I thought I could do and what positive contributions I thought I could make. And I think the last campaign with Judy and I, we did the same thing. But that's not always the case. I mean, I have a letter was sent out recently which suggested that, well, didn't suggest, it said that Judy and I have done nothing but follow the leadership. We've made no contributions to the keeping the taxes as they are, and other comments like that, which, you know, people complain about negative advertising. I think we all saw it. We were all bombarded with it on the TV recently. It doesn't help anything. They say negative advertising can be effective. I hope it's not effective with most of you. And I hope when you see that kind of stuff that you indicate that your displeasure with it. That's all I have to say. I was advised by a venerable member of the panel, don't take it personally when these kind of things occur. It's only politics. Well, politics is what we make it. And I'd like to see us make it something that people can be proud of. That's all I have.
Well, then advise him at the upper level running for the offices.
Well, I certainly will. Every chance I get.
It generally doesn't get negative like that. Amy?
All right, a couple things. I don't think anybody's mentioned, but the tree lighting that we had the Saturday after Thanksgiving, the tree lighting itself was an outstanding presentation. I think in my lifetime, this has been the highest attended tree lighting that I've ever seen. It was packed. I've never seen so many people in the park, and there was just a ton of energy. The park looked absolutely great. when we flipped on the lights. We had participation from so many different groups, from the choirs that were there. You know, we had Mike Colazzo was kind of emceeing and keeping that energy going throughout the night. Just lots of different tables set up, and just really a wonderful thing that continues to go on. It's such a great tradition. It's one that I'm very, very proud of in our town that I still enjoy. And I appreciate that the mayor still lets me do the countdown, because it's, you know, something that gets me all excited. But it was a really great night. And Brett, I just want your team to be commended on the
absolutely.
Work and the lights.
Yeah. Beautiful job.
But also all the other organizations, including the Historic Society, who really had a huge effort in hand in that evening. It was wonderful. I do want to wish some safety to all the hunters out there, as I've already gotten the one line from my dad, which I get every year. Aim, I'm sorry, you were born in the wrong week. I'm going out in the woods. So to everybody who's out there hunting, please be safe out there. And want to mention and recognize that today is Pearl Harbor Day. 74 years ago was that fateful day that, as we all know, will go down in infamy. I think we'd be remiss if we just didn't recognize it and know that those who were involved in it, either lost or still surviving, you know, you're in our hearts, you're in our prayers, and we remember. But there was something else significant that happened on that day that not a lot of people really know about, but our mayor was born that day.
Whoa. How old is he now?
Well, it happened 74 years ago, so I'm not going to tell his age.
I stopped counting at 50.
But I consider myself Roger's work wife, and there's only so many times I get to embarrass him a little bit. And Lisa actually helped me take that to a whole nother level today. I had something small planned, but she went to epic proportions. So we have some cupcakes here. And now I see the fire chiefs have left, so we won't put all the candles, Mayor, but we'll put one.
Okay.
And we're going to sing you a quick happy birthday. So, I'm going to light your fire, baby.
That's on the record.
His wife knows. It's okay. All right, Mr. Mayor, with that, we're going to start singing. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, dear Roger.
Happy birthday to you.
Make your work.
Thank you. And you're all welcome to
have a cupcake. Everybody's invited after the meeting to grab a cupcake.
Appreciate it. Thank you, everyone. Are you finished, Dave?
I am finished, yes. I wanted to end with a song.
I tell everybody that when I was a little boy, I never thought much about my birthday. Because growing up during the Second World War, when my father was away, I didn't get to see my father till 1946. He had enlisted in the Navy for the duration, and like so many of those World War II volunteers, it was a long war. But as I got older, I started thinking about the day. I had an uncle that was stationed at Schofield Air Barracks on Pearl Harbor. And actually, by being born that day, I saved his life, because he came stateside December 6th to see his sister, my mother. And I didn't realize that till years later, till I heard the story. But it's something that always makes you think about it. There's a lot of historic days. I think, you know, every time you hear Roosevelt talk about the day it'll live to infamy, I think about it, and just hope that everyone can appreciate what our service people do, our men and women, to make this country great, and we owe them a debt of gratitude. So I thank all of you for your well wishes, and I guess we'll keep counting. The tree lighting was phenomenal. Reverend Ash and I, every year we have a joke going that I wonder how many people were in the park that night. And I said, can we get the latest Chamber of Commerce figures? And one year I said to him, I think we have 200 people. He said, you're 50 short, Roger. He said, I counted all of them. Well, we probably had over 375 people there on that Saturday night. You couldn't move in the park. And I think not only the highlights of looking at the fantastic job that the Public Works people did in putting up those thousands of lights, The fact if you drive by it tonight, you see the lights on, you can appreciate it. But it's so much more fulfilling when you see all the people in the park, and they really come out for that, not only for the Santa Claus that your granddaughter would love, but all the goodies. And I know the work that with hot chocolate. How much hot chocolate did you go through in,
wow,
in cookies?
We were out, and we had gallons. We must have had, like, that's each one holds, we probably had about 25 gallons of chocolate.
Yeah, so it was a great evening. The weather held. The other great thing that happened during the month was over at Horizons Woods Landing, they received an award for the Gold Star community. And I think it was very noteworthy. You saw the article in the paper that Charles Pritchard did. To have a community like that, I think it rivals any of the other age-restricted communities in the county. And I think the residents that are there are very involved, and I can't thank them enough for choosing our township to live in. So I think it was very noteworthy. And Arlene, I know you're very proud because you live there, and they put on a nice celebration. There must have been, what, 200 people there that night? So it was very well attended. But Judy, I was at Dickens at a holiday, and I didn't buy any earrings, but I did go over to the lady that made all the chocolate, and I picked up some of the greatest chocolate-covered pretzels you could ever taste. I mean, these were all homemade, and each one of them had a different flavor, whether they had candy cane on them or they had pieces of M&Ms, but all of them were very great. So, you know, when we talk about December is a very interesting month because so many great things happen. I mean, beside the holidays, and your birthday is going to be in 2 days, too.
Yeah.
So, but we're not talking about your age yet.
That's okay.
Okay, it's fine. We're not going to tell anybody. But I honestly think that remembering birthdays and celebrating with people that you enjoy being around. It was funny. I got a card in the mail today from someone, and it said, it's your birthday. Hip, hip, and I open up the card, it said, hip replacement, happy birthday. So, you know, at that point, you see what happens when you get to be a certain age. But I like to thank everybody. Your well wishes are certainly appreciated, and I wish all of you many, many more and a great holiday season coming up. With that, I'll open it up to the public. Anyone in the public wish to speak? Come on up, Art.
I just want to let you know that I submitted a photo from our very first wine festival, which was two people enjoying their wine in front of the lighthouse, to the Community Association industry in New Jersey. And I won.
Yay!
And it will be on the cover of 1,600 magazines going out to communities throughout New Jersey. I thought you'd like to know that.
That's great.
And what a great thing for next year. For advanced ticket sales, right?
Absolutely.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. Anybody else in the public?
100.
Rodney, your comments tonight about people making that, I learned a long time ago. What I don't read and what I don't listen to doesn't bother me. And I think, you know, just, and you've run enough for public office to know. I mean, in this day and age, you're right. Negative does sell, even though people don't like it. But it is what it is, and we just have to learn to deal with it. And hopefully, as time goes on, you know, you'll try to let some of it go.
Move to close the public portion.
Hopefully.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Good.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
Second.
Half a meeting.
Meeting adjourned.